الحمد والثناء لرب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا أبو القاسم المصطفى محمد
صل على آل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم جميعا. It is a honor to be a part of the community here at Al Bashir Foundation, to be a guest here with my brothers here in Phoenix. And I thank you all for your hospitality and invitation. May Allah reward you all. Jazakumullah. I want to present the discussion after giving condolences to the Imam of the age, to the Imam of the time, Sahib al-Asr wa-Zaman, for the grief and sorrow and the madlumiyya of the istishhad and martyrdom of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam. We have some traditions that also mention the 7th of Safar as being a marking the birth of Imam al-Qadim alayhi salam. Also, in remembrance of these imams, this gathering, inshallah, is a gift to our a'imma. I present the discussion tonight with the question. We see more and more today, in today's world, things happening, and surely a lot of these things are signs of Akhir al-Zaman. But we want to look at these things and analyze some of the reasons why some of the tragedies are happening in the world. Why in society has the human being become suffering? And emotionally, spiritually, psychologically, you find today, more than ever before, people suffering from depression, anxiety, many other psychological disorders. You find people in the world, tragic things happening, people becoming suicidal, homicidal, and tragic things happening in the world. What is the cause or the root cause of these things? So I want to look at that in light of the book, the Holy Quran, the traditions of the Ahl al-Bayt, and also from the Seerah of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. I want to gather the answer to these questions. We can add to the question, what is the reason why, even for the believers, they have areas where they have weaknesses, that even for the mu'mineen, you might find that people, even in their most basic actions and their prayers. They may lack their consciousness, presence of mind. All of their rituals and worship that they do, sometimes they're going through motions, but without any substance. When it comes to a dua or a prayer that is longer, sometimes they don't have the attention span. What is the root cause of these as well? What is it that puts a person in a state of being motivated? If we want to sum up these issues in the world, in society, in our communities, in our individual selves, and to see one of the main root causes for these flaws, we can point to lack of purpose. Purpose, hadaf, a qasd, a goal, a reason. This is why people do what they do. They see and understand, they have a goal of what they want to achieve. So for an individual, he has goals that he sets in life. And in that process, he may encounter some difficulties. But how does he overcome those difficulties? Because his eyes are fixed on his goal, and it gives him purpose. When a person is going to college and they're taking a lot of classes and a lot of courses, at some point, for most students, it gets difficult, it gets hard, or they question, should I change my major? Should I study this? Should I study something else? But what keeps them able to continue is when they have a purpose, when they see a reason, and they understand this reason and this purpose. In society, the same is true. What is it that people want in their society? What is it that we want to achieve as a nation, as a people? As an ummah, where are we trying to go? And it becomes when people in a society reach a point where they lose their focus, they lose their purpose, they seek other things. They fall towards other things in society when they feel that they lose their purpose. Addiction is very prevalent in today's world. Addiction to many things. Sometimes this is the same reason and the same cause. A person and their focus and their purpose. So the same goes for a believer and a mu'min. And we can put this into categories. We have the ibadah on one side, that is the worship, the actions that we do, our prayers, our fasting. We have the verse in Surah Dhariyat, verse 56, which mentions that Allah says He did not create jinn and man illa liya'budun. So we have this ibadah on one side. He says, I did not create you except for this purpose, a reason, a purpose. But we have to understand this purpose. Ibadah alone is not enough. It's not sufficient though. If someone goes and they stand and they go through motions of standing and bowing and ruku and sujood, and they give salam, that may technically be considered ibadah. But if it did not have purpose for that person, it may not even truly be accepted. So on the other hand, we have something else, and that is the ubudiyya, the servitude. So there's a worship, but there's something that makes that worship mean something, and that is servitude. And when we look at what is servitude from the words of our a'imma, from the words and the seerah of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, it will put into light for us, how can we achieve our goals? How can our life maintain its purpose? How can we be successful? It says in Surah Al-Mulk, Allah mentions about death and life. These are realities. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ Allah even explains to us, what is the purpose of these realities? What is the reason for this death and this life? It's not by chance. Allah was not bored and decided, I'll create people to see what happens. He says that he created death and life, liyabluwakum, so that he may test you all. So you go through some difficulties and some tests. And what is the purpose of the test? Even within that, there is purpose. To give a person purpose. It says through this test, it becomes clear the level that a person wants to attain. Ayyukum ahsanu amala. What level of good deeds and action a person wants to attain. When you go to school, you have to take some test to go to the next grade, to graduate, so on and so forth, to get into certain schools. And this test is what's going to differentiate between people. So it's the reality of life is that there will be these tests. There will be some hardships. There will be some difficulties. There will be some challenges. And for the mu'mineen, the lives of the a'imma are a constant reminder. It's a reminder for us. When we face challenges, how to overcome them. During the month of Muharram, we talk a lot, obviously, about the tragedy of Karbala. The tragic incidents that happened. A story that even the coldest heart becomes soft. These are the words of non-Muslims, who are philosophers, who have said that even the coldest heart in hearing the tragedy of Karbala becomes softened. But we have to think about the same level of importance about the role of the Imam. What Imam Hussein alayhi salam spoke in his letter to the people of Kufa, he gives them an explanation of the role of the Imam. He has a duty, he has a purpose, he has an objective, he has a goal. You know, every action that we do, every single action, in order for that action to be accepted, it has to be urbatan Allah. We have to do this for the sake of Allah. And that doing it for the sake of Allah becomes one of the ways that the action becomes accepted. Now that could be a person doing a tremendously big action or a very small action. It could be handing someone a cup of tea, it could be cleaning up, it could be, you know, financing a whole mosque. All of these things have to be qurbatan Allah to be accepted. For the lives of the Ahlul Bayt, we don't have an instance where sometimes the actions were for Allah and sometimes they were not. So they were always, in every case, in every instant, only for the sake of Allah. So if Imam Hussein alayhi salam goes to battle and he goes and becomes a martyr, a shaheed, this is for the sake of Allah. And the same is true for Imam Hassan, for Imam Ali, for all of the a'imma. What they did at their time was only for the sake of Allah. And that purpose of their action allowed them to be successful even when it was most difficult. It's not easy to bury your child. It's not easy to watch your children give their lives. And think how Imam Hassan must have felt to know that he could not even be there at that time. That he did not even have the companions to come alongside him. A handful of people. But in that difficulty for him, he did not lose sight of his goal and his purpose. Even in the treaty with Muawiyah, it was for the sake of Allah. And only the purpose of pleasing Allah is in mind. Even though it may be difficult, Muawiyah is a tyrant, he's a zalim. How difficult is it for the Imam to have to make a treaty with this person who knows that he's not going to honor that agreement? It was difficult for him. But in that difficulty, his focus still gave him purpose. So when we look at the problems that we see in today's society, one of the reasons why the problems exist is because society has become more secular. So when you remove God from the equation, then you also are removing purpose. You're also removing the goal. So people find themselves moving towards atheism. Similar to the time of many previous prophets and idol worshiping. They find themselves lowering themselves in their ideology. One of the greatest dangers for people who live in Western society is to lose their own purpose. To become a part of the society that's secular and to adopt secular methods and approaches to their life. The greatest tragedy in Christianity was removing and making the religion completely secular. It doesn't matter what you do during the week, as long as you go to church on Sunday. What happens during the week happens. A I used to have a commercial, what happens in Vegas stays in Vegas. What happens during the week stays during the week. As long as Sunday, I'm a good person and I repent, then all is well. The tragedy for the Muslim, especially in today's world, is where they have taken their religion and assumed and adopted this secular approach. So they've altered their purpose. How? By taking Muharram and making it essentially the Sunday for Muslims. By making Imam Hussein the Jesus Christ who died for your sins of Islam. Throughout the rest of the year, maybe I do this, maybe I do that, say this, say that. As long as I can, on the day of Ashura, shed a tear for Imam Hussein, then that's enough. As long as I can remember, because Imam Hassan alayhi salam was so madloom, as long as I can honor him in a majlis, then what I do throughout the rest of the year, it doesn't matter. Then it becomes the same approach. Jesus died for our sins, it becomes the same approach. That we adopt this method. So for us, it's imperative that we have to go back and put our purpose behind our actions. Not just something we do for the sake of doing, but understanding the reason why. One of the greatest things that people have concern about when they come and immigrate into Western countries like the United States is obviously, and rightfully so, the concern for their children. I want my children to know the Ahlul Bayt. I want them to understand their religion. I want them to be good Muslims. And that's especially a challenge in a society that does not promote those same values. It's a big challenge. But how do we give purpose to a young person? When we look at some of the lives of the A'immah from very young ages, they were very mature intellectually, mentally, spiritually. How do we give that same meaning and purpose to our young ones? So when they pray, they feel purpose, they feel attached, they feel connected. When they want to participate in majlis, they're not concerned about when is it ending, they're engaged. How do we give them that purpose that they need? When we look at one of the most beautiful aspects of the religion of Islam, is that it challenges us to think, to know, to understand. It repeats in the Quran, there are signs for those who reflect, for those who know, for those who think. So we have to give understanding. Understanding is necessary. And Imam Ali alayhi salam, he gives us this example for raising children. He reminds us that our children live in a different age, in a different era than we did. That they have different circumstances and they have to be raised accordingly according with those circumstances, with their situation, with their needs. So religion has to be put into their context so that they can be able to feel it, understand it, and that gives them a purpose. That gives them a goal. Sometimes people, they tell their children, do this because you have to do this. You have to pray because you're supposed to pray. You're a Muslim, you have to pray. You have to go to majlis. We have to do this. This is just what we do. And sometimes because there's not a tangible answer, there's not there's not dalail that is mahsus and they can really understand and grasp, then sometimes that leaves them disconnected. But we want them to have that connection to religion, that connection to the Ahlul Bayt. Once I was traveling to Iran for ziyarat, and in my travel, our plane got delayed or went the wrong way, and I ended up in Phoenix some years ago. And it took 3 days for them to fix the itinerary and planes and everything and get our luggage. And so I spent a few days in Phoenix. This was some years ago. So while I was here, I thought to myself that I should go see some of the local community, visit a masjid. So I Googled and found some centers. I went to a center. I went to a masjid. And I was just wearing my regular clothes. I wasn't dressed as a sheikh or an alim. And I called the number. They said, yeah, sure, we're not really open, but you can come if you want. I said, thank you, I came. When I came to the center, there were a few kids, and they were sitting in the hall, and all the adults were having a meeting. Some of the adults or the board members, they were having a meeting. And so I came in, I made wudu, and I was praying, and then I stopped to talk to some of the kids. And meanwhile, the adults were having a very fiery meeting, and they were going back and forth. And the kids were playing on their phones and their iPads or tablets or whatever. So I asked them, what's your name? And they had beautiful names of the Ahlul Bayt, of course, of the Imams. So I asked them, you know, do you know the names of all of your Imams? They knew some, one or two or three. I said, do you know the next Imam? Do you know who's this Imam? That's your name. You're named after this Imam. I know about FIFA. I don't know about this Imam. And back and forth, there was arguing about something very trivial, something not important. Are we going to have chicken or are we going to have meat? Dajaj, lamb, back and forth. Argument about chicken or meat for the program, for the majlis, and the children don't know who their imams are. Priorities are misplaced sometimes. And unless that purpose is given and there's a connection made, then we'll find our children and our next generation becoming actually more disconnected. So there's a great danger and a great importance that has to be given with creating ways to make that connection. Sometimes as Muslim, we take days off. We have vacation. Shaitan doesn't have vacation. He works 24/7, nonstop. And he has employees that work 24/7, nonstop. And they are always looking for something to connect our young people to, which is not positive things. Through film, through music, through internet, through any means, through clothes, through school, through education, through any means. They look for a way to give them some purpose. But all purpose is not good purpose. Sometimes it's false purpose. They give them a false goal. Try to be like this, instead of trying to be like Imam Hassan, try to be like this actor. Try to be like this person. Lose your role models. How do we make the Ahlul Bayt for our next generation that they have that connection, that they see them as their heroes? Not just Spider-Man's a hero, Batman's a hero. No, Imam Hassan is a hero. Do you know what kind of strength it takes to be the son of Imam Ali alayhi salam, to be the brother of Imam Hussein, to carry that burden of imamat, to have to teach and lead people, and you're not giving the freedom, to have to try to save the religion by having to sit at the table with the tyrant? These are very difficult terms. And when we face difficulties in our own lives, we'll understand better what Imam Hassan had to do and how he was able to do it with the purpose that he had. And we'll look to them as our role models. Uswatun Hassana. Right? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Uswatun Hassana. He says, we placed in him a perfect example for you. And in all of the imams, there's this example for us to follow, to learn from, so that we ourselves have purpose and we give that sense of purpose to the next generation as well. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. There is a mention about a person who he was concerned about his actions when he would pray. Sometimes people would say, MashaAllah, look how he prays. And he himself, he didn't want to have riyah, he didn't want to be showing off. And so it says that he leaves the city that he lives in and he goes somewhere where there's a city where nobody's there. He was trying to get away from the habit of doing actions for other people. And he goes into it's raining outside, he goes into an abandoned mosque. In the masjid, he begins to pray. And it's just him alone. And while he's there, he notices that there seems like someone has entered. And he begins to think that I should, you know, really say my best qira'ah. I should make, you know, really pronounce my Arabic as best as I can. And I should make long rukus and because someone is watching. And he started to do again the same mistake that he had done before. And after he completed his long prayers, he turns and he sees that the shadow that he saw was the shadow of a dog. So all of his purpose was qurbatan ila al-kalb. It wasn't for the sake of Allah. When actions are just actions alone, and they don't have ubudiyah, and they're not for the service and servitude of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those actions do not have much value. If someone just does the action, they pray, they go through motions of prayer, or they go to majalis and they sit there so they can say that, you know, they don't want to have a guilty conscience that Muharram came and they didn't go to majlis, so they go and they sit in the majlis. But without substance, without ubudiyah, then there's not really any value in that sitting, in that praying, or that fasting, or whatever the action is. The value in it is when it becomes solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone in a famous tradition, Imam Sadiq alayhi salam, he explains the reality of what ubudiyat is. There's a famous tradition called the Hadith of Unwan al-Basri. Unwan was an older man, 94, 96 years old. He was studying and learning from a teacher, but when Imam Sadiq came to the city, alayhi salam, he decides that he wants to learn from Imam Sadiq. Because Imam Sadiq is, as the in some ways we will call the father of the Ja'fari Madhab, and with so many students and such vast knowledge, and he was teaching so many people, he wanted to become one of those special students of the Imam. And he seeks out an opportunity to learn from the Imam. And the hadith is lengthy, but at one point he tells the Imam to teach me something. Teach me, guide me, give me some advice. The Imam tells him, "Laysa ilm bita'allum." Knowledge is not just, I said this to you and you learned it. That's not the reality of knowledge. He says, what's knowledge? He says, knowledge is a nur, nurun. يَقَعَ فِي قَلْبِ مَنْ يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى أَنْ يَهْدِيَهُ. It is a light that Allah places in the heart of the person who He wishes to guide. He says, so if you want knowledge, then you have to seek it through Allah. He says, well, how do I do that? You have to seek it through ubudiyah. He says, what's the haqiqat of ubudiyah? What's the reality of this servitude? And the Imam explains to him three things. He says, the first is that you recognize and understand that whatever you have is not yours. This is the first step. Because we're trying to get to the point where we truly have a purpose and we do our actions for Allah. So we understand that ubudiyat is a way to get to there. But what is ubudiyat? The Imam breaks it down for us. One, It is understanding that nothing or everything that you have is not even yours. In Surah Al-Baqarah, it mentions about who the mu'mineen are. يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ And they give their zakat, but it says also, وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يَنْفِقُونَ. So there's something important about this. It's not saying that there are people who give in charity or they give donations or... It's not what it's saying. It says, مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ, from that which we gave to them. So part of the condition of a mu'min is that he understands that whatever he gives, he's giving from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not giving from himself. He says the haqiqah of ubudiyyah, number one, is that he recognizes that nothing belongs to him. If he gives something, he says, I give it from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the second thing, is that he doesn't try to, he recognizes that Allah is in charge of the results. Allah is in charge of his affairs. Ultimately, everything is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It says in the Quran, مَعَلَى رَسُولِ إِلَّا الْبَلَاغِ مَعَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغِ الْمُبِينِ. The Prophet's job was to share the message of Islam. Not to force anyone to accept, but to make sure that he shares it in clear terms. The results are in the hands of Allah. It says, Ubudiyyah means that I understand that effort is on my responsibility. Results are in the hands of Allah. Sometimes we think about the results as if we have control over the results. I made this dua, why didn't this happen? I was trying to get married and it didn't work out. Wanted this to happen and that didn't happen. And we're worried about the results. But the results are in Allah's hands. What's in our hands is what we can do. A person can study. The results of the tests are in Allah's hands. Granted that he did his part. And he says the last part is that a person is preoccupied with doing what is wajib and staying away from that which is haram. This means that what Allah says has more value than anything else or what anyone else says. If Allah has said it's permissible, or if Allah has said that it's an obligation, then it's more valuable than what people said. It's amazing. It says about the person who is shy in front of people, but he's not shy in front of Allah. He's shy to pray. People might see me praying. I'm shy. He's not shy in front of his Lord. When we look at Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, there's beautiful hadith that explains about his worship. And when it explains about his worship, you see the purpose in all of his actions. And you see the result of the goal and the purpose that he has. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam is explaining this tradition. And he says about Imam Hassan ibn Ali, the kana a'badu nas fi zamanihi, that during his era he was the best of worshippers. Wa azhadahum wa afdhaluhum, the best of them, the most ascetic of them, not attached to the dunya, the material things. It says, وَكَانَ إِذَا هَجَّ مَاشِيَ, that when he would go to Hajj, he would walk often. وَرُبَّمَا, and oftentimes that walking would be حَافِيًا, would be barefooted walking. Imam Hassan alayhi salam is speaking about that he was so great in his worship that even when he went to Hajj, and several times that he would go to Hajj, even if people would offer, we can give you a camel, a horse, it says many times he would walk, and he would often walk barefooted. وَكَانَ إِذَا ذُكَرَ الْمَوْتِ بَكَى, and when death was mentioned, he would weep and he would cry. He understood this reality. In Surah Anfal it says, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ, their hearts are in awe. Their hearts tremble in awe when they hear the remembrance of Allah. Not that they hide their identity, who they are, or they're ashamed to be Muslim, or they're ashamed to pray, ashamed of their name, ashamed of their iman. It says, no, when Allah is mentioned, their hearts tremble in awe. It says, when death is mentioned, Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, he would weep. وَذَا ذُكِرَ الْقَلْبِ وَذَا ذُكِرَ الْقَبْرِ بَكَى, when the grave and the punishment, the most lonely time for a human being, when you have no one, there's no people to be ashamed of or shy in front of, it's just you, Allah, and your actions. And Nakir and Munkir are serious people, serious angels rather. Just you and your actions. It says when that moment is mentioned about the qabr, he would weep and he would cry. وَذَا ذُكِرَ الْبَعْثُ وَالنُّشُورِ, when the time of resurrection was mentioned, he would weep and he would cry. Like it says in Surah Abasa, يَوْمَ يَفِرُ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ, maybe the most closest person to you in your life. Can you imagine a person, he's running away from his brother. He's thinking about, what did I do in the dunya? Wa ummihi wa abi wa sahibatihi wa bani, the closest people to a human being, his parents, his spouse. لِكُلِّ إِمْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَ أَذِنْ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِي. On this day, everyone's so worried and concerned about what they did, what they did not do, their actions, their deeds, their hasanat, or their sayyat. They're worried about us on this day. He says, when that time would come, he would weep when the afterlife and the qiyamah was mentioned. When the crossing of the sirat was mentioned, it says that he would weep. When standing in front of Allah was mentioned, it says that he would scream until he would fall, yakshi alayhi minha, that he would go unconscious from that. he would will and go unconscious when it was mentioned about standing before your Lord. It says, وَإِذَا كَانَ قَامَ فِي صَلَاتِهِ, when he would stand in his prayers, he would tremble and shake because he was standing before his Lord. Brothers and sisters, if even just the salat and the prayer of Imam Hassan is a lesson for us, and we compare our prayers and how we pray and our purpose when we pray to this, where the Imam is saying, where it's saying that when he stood before Allah, that his body trembled. This is the Imam who is ma'soom, whose body trembles when he stands before his Lord, when he stands before his Rabb. Then how do I or you stand before our Rabb and we pray, and between our Allahu Akbar and Salam, something happens, but we cannot even call it prayer? We've lost our purpose. One of the great urafa of our era, his name is Ayatollah Muhammad Taqi Behjat, rahmatullah alayh. One of my teachers, he told me, you should see this person, visit him if you can. And I didn't know who is this, you know, great scholar and mystic. But I tried to, I said, I'll go and pray behind him and I'll go and talk to him. He would pray in a masjid that was close to the haram of Hazrat Ma'asuma salamu alayha. And I went for the first time, I was younger then, and I went for the first time and I said, oh my God, there's no room. There's no place. A room like this, there wasn't one place to pray. The line would go into the street, and there was no place to pray. So I said, okay, I'll come back another day. Two, three, a few more times, I came back, no place to pray. So I came one day on a Friday, which is a day off, early in the morning, before Fajr prayer, and there was still some space. So I got an opportunity to pray behind him. When he used to pray, actually you can see the YouTube videos, he would be so focused, uninterrupted, and when he would pronounce his words, the surah, it was almost as if it was difficult. He would cry in every single prayer. It's as if the hairs on your body would stand up. It was a feeling that of awareness, of understanding. So when Imam Hassan alayhi salam is saying that he stands before his Lord and his body shakes in prayer, this is because he understands that Allah's magnitude and what and who he is standing in front of. We have to take a lesson from Imam Hassan and understand our prayers, understand our ibadah, understand our worship. Ibadah means any action that we do for the sake of Allah. A child smiles at their parents. That is an ibadah. A person walks to give, do a good deed. That walking even is an ibadah. A person says a kind word to someone for the sake of Allah, that becomes a form of worship. And that has to translate into our daily prayers as well. I'll come to a close with an example about in our prayer when we give salam. And we're saying this and explaining this because when we understand and analyze these things, inshallah, it gives us a greater sense of understanding and purpose and connection with our prayers. We know that in our prayers we say assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh when we're ending towards the end of our salams, correct? So the question came up, who is this kum, the pronoun kum here, you all, who is it referring to? Who is it a reference to? And the question is very important itself. And I encourage people as much as you can to have questions. There is no bad questions. The only bad questions are the ones you don't ask and they become doubt in a mind. They prevent you from becoming closer to Allah. So it was explained about the answer to this question, who is this kum and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. That when a person goes to pray, when they do takbiratul ihram, they're saying that Allah is greater than everything. And at that moment, they have to disconnect from this world. They disconnect. They shouldn't think about the person next to them. They shouldn't be thinking about the problem at school, the problem at home, this problem with family, that which they want to do, money they want to make. None of these things they should think about. When they say Allah is greater, that means that they disconnect. Everything else is less. Nothing else is greater. And this salam at the end of the prayer, this salam is because when a person said Allahu Akbar in the beginning of their prayer, they disconnected from this world, they left this world. Like it says that Salat is Mi'rajul Mu'min, they disconnected from this world. And it says this salam is because they come back to this world. They revert back. And they give salams to those who are present around them. And it says for the person who when he said Allahu Akbar, he was constantly thinking about this, about that, about this person and that person and this thing and that thing. He says they don't have any salams to give. That their salams are actually incorrect. Because they didn't go anywhere. They didn't disconnect from this world. And they were constantly thinking about the problems and the issues of this world. By understanding just the salam alone, and how in order for our prayers to be correct, we have to disconnect from the material problems in this world, then we can understand why Imam Hassan is shaking in his prayers. Because there's nothing about this world to shake about. It's only about standing before your Lord which creates this. Sallallahu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. With the love of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, please recite one louder salawat. As-salamu alayka ya Hassan al-Mujtaba. As-salamu alayka ya Hassan al-Mujtaba. As-salamu alayka ya Kareem Ahl Bayt Rasulullah. As-salamu alayka ya Ibn Wali Allah. As-salamu alayka ya Ibn Rasulullah. As-salamu alayka ya Hassan al-Mujtaba. Peace be unto you, O Hassan al-Mujtaba. Peace be unto you, O son of Rasulullah. Peace be unto you, O son of Wali Allah. Peace be unto you, O Hassan al-Mujtaba. Every imam is like stars in the heavens, a light on the earth and in the sky. This is why we grieve when they die. This is why we grieve their demise. Their enemies are the a'da of Allah. Their enemies are the enemies of Allah. And they plot so savagely a great tragedy, the tragedy of killing Hassan al-Mujtaba. He carried out his duty, Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, even though it was heavy and difficult for him. He was poisoned by even his own family. This was Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. And when we drink, we think, Ya Hussein. Every time we drink water, we remember Ya Hussein. And what about the brother of Imam al-Hussein? Imam Hassan was given something to drink. He was poisoned in the same way. His body grew ill and full of pain. And he still felt sad, Imam al-Hassan al-Mujtaba. He felt sad, but not for his own grief. He felt sad for his brother Hussein. Imam Hassan knew that when he died on that day, that someone would be there to bury his body. But what about the body of Abu Abdullah? Who would bury the body of Abu Abdullah? Who would bury the body of Hussein ibn Ali? Died on the grounds of Karbala, filled with blood of Karbanbala. Who would bury that body with spears and swords, bloody and broken bones? Who would bury those children like Ali Asghar? Who would bury an infant from Karbala? Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba would weep, but he wouldn't cry for his own pain. He cried for the pain of Hussein. Sayya'lamuna alladhina dhalamu ayyu munqalabin yanqalibun. إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ.